ourselves and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Almighty and merciful God,
in repentant faith, we come before the Lord in confession.
We confess to you that we are sinful
by nature, unrighteous, and separated from you.
We have sinned against you by our selfish thoughts, our unkind words, and our unloving actions. We so often neglect devotion to your word and spurn the gifts of your Spirit.
We have not kept your commandments,
and in so doing have failed to show our love for you. For the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray, forgive us. For the sake of Jesus, who gave his life on the cross for us and was raised from the dead, God does forgive us all of our sins. I announce his grace to all of you. In the stead and by the command of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you. Lord would not have listened. But truly, God has listened. He has attended to the voice of my prayer. Blessed be God, because he has not rejected my prayer or removed his steadfast love from me. The epistle is from 1 Peter chapter 3. Now who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled, but in your hearts regard Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the Spirit, in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison, because they formerly did not obey, when God's patience waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were brought safely through water. Baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers having been subjected to him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
I brought a little help with me. And you know what Jesus said? Jesus said, I'm going to give you a helper. You don't have to follow him on your own. He gives us the Holy Spirit to help us follow him, to walk in his ways, to believe in him and trust him, and to know that he's our Lord and Savior, which is an amazing gift because we could never do it on our own. Thanks for your help, Larry. And I know you'll never sit there again. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. John chapter 14 this morning, we're picking up where we left off last week. And in John chapter 14, verse 15, Jesus says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. Now I'm curious, I wonder what your initial reaction to those words is. I think some of you would think to yourself, or even say, absolutely. A relationship with our Lord implies a changed life. We are no longer going to be conformed to this world, but our lives are transformed to reflect his presence and his holiness in our lives. And yet, on the other hand, I know that there's also some here, especially if you have Lutheran blood running through your veins, who would say, wait a minute, my relationship with the Lord is not determined by my behavior because I'm not good at being obedient. My relationship with the Lord is based on his righteousness and his grace for me. So what do we do with that statement? And Jesus even repeats it later when he says, whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. So it's very important that we remember when and why Jesus was speaking these words. We have something to eat, gives you something to drink. That's what moms do. That's just part of who they are. If you're retired law enforcement, you walk into church on a Sunday morning, you kind of look over the room, check out the people. You're not forcing yourself to do this. It just comes naturally. It's part of who you are. It's amazing what happens when Christ is a part of who we are, and the Helper, His Spirit, is dwelling in us. We forgive other people because we've been forgiven so much. Forgiveness is a part of who we are. We give because we've been given so much. Generosity is a part of who we are. We witness because if we talk about our lives, we talk about ourselves, Jesus always comes up in the conversation. He is a part of who we are. And that is how His love continues to shape our lives. It's part of who we are now, but it's also because Jesus gives us a lot of help. In baptism, He's granted you the gift of His Holy Spirit. The Spirit that is a part of who you are now. Reminding you of His teaching, helping you understand what He has said, giving you the right words at the right moment to talk about this Jesus who's a part of your life. If I have a group of preschool kids together and I say to them, I need some help. Who wants to be a helper? All the hands go up. When you're 4 and 5 years old, you don't want to miss out on anything action. When you and I aren't sure we can do it, and we say, I need some help. His hands go up. he might live